Here's a deceptively simple question for you. What's common between a group of male fireflies flashing on a tree, a flock of birds, a school of fish, and this bunch of metronomes? Okay, why this video? So the story goes like this. A few days ago, Mr. Kanemaru, a subscriber of this channel, sent me a rather interesting video. He and his wife were totally perplexed by these videos where a lot of metronomes are put together with differently timed ticks. Within 1 to 2 minutes, all these metronomes would start ticking at the same time in perfect synchrony. And Mr. Kanemaru and his wife watched many such videos on the internet, ranging from 5 metronomes all the way up to 100 metronomes, but they couldn't figure out how was this possible. So they asked me if I could help. And as you know, the purpose of this channel is to explain complex scientific ideas in simple to understand everyday language. So I took the challenge up. So without further ado, let's get started. Now, coming to the basic question, what's common between the fireflies, the birds, the metronomes, as well as the fish? They all start as random motions, not synchronized at all, not aware about others, not aware about the group, but eventually, within a short period of time, they achieve spontaneous synchronization. So basically, random things start on their own in the randomized fashion, but eventually they come together, get in line with each other, and start depicting spontaneous synchronization on a large scale. Now, this all sounds very simple. We have observed this in the nature. We have seen the school of fish in the sea. We have seen the flock of birds in the sky. But this raises a very fundamental question. Isn't spontaneous synchronization against the law of entropy? The law of entropy is the only law in physics that actually talks about the passage of time. So basically what it says is things tend to go from orderly to disorderly as the time passes. For example, a hot cup of tea. If you leave it on a table, unattended, uncovered, after some time, it loses heat, it gets cold. Similarly, let's say a building. If it's left unattended and if you don't do regular maintenance works on it, eventually it would collapse. The second law of thermodynamics, or the law of entropy, says that things tend to go from orderly to disorderly. But the spontaneous synchronization phenomena that we see in nature suggests the opposite, because in spontaneous synchronization, things actually start in disorderly random fashion, but eventually it leads to order and synchronous behavior. So that's something to think about. Now, the most important word here is spontaneous. So now let's see how this phenomenon happens in living organisms. So I'm talking here about the birds, the fish, and the fireflies, the male fireflies. Wildlife photographers as well as scientists have been studying these phenomena from as back as 1950s. Let's talk about that. In living organisms, spontaneous synchronization works on 3 simple rules as I understand it. Rule number 1, each organism aligns itself or couples itself with its nearest neighbors. Now, this is very important. What do I mean by that? For example, this firefly aligns itself only to its neighboring firefly. It doesn't, for example, couple or align itself with a firefly, let's say, in the middle of the group or at the other end of the group. So that's rule number 1. Rule number 2, each organism corrects or alters its own natural behavior based on the feedback that it gets from its nearest neighbors. Rule number 3. Each organism works in its own self-interests. There's no leader-follower relationship going on here. It's all happening spontaneously. That's why I said the word spontaneous is very important here. So there's no single organism that comes out as the first one to glow or the first one to start making a school of fish or a flock of birds. All of it happens spontaneously. So it's all self-interest. To unsuspecting eyes, it does look like group behavior, but in reality, it's individual behavior. So that's very important in understanding the spontaneous synchronization phenomena. What do I mean by that? Well, what it means simply is each individual bird in the flock is trying to save itself from a predator in the sky. Each individual fish is trying to not get eaten by a bigger hungry fish. And similarly, each individual male firefly is trying to attract a female firefly, and the female firefly is actually glowing very dimly on the ground beneath. But there's an anomaly here, isn't it? Because if you look at the flock of birds and the school of fish, yes, it all sounds very natural. It's all part of evolution. So maybe evolutionary forces kind of convince them to go for spontaneous synchronization. But what about the fireflies? Because according to the theory of evolution, a male should do something different from other males. It shouldn't glow together with the other male fireflies. So let's have a deeper look at why the fireflies seem to go against the idea of evolution. Scientists suggest two probable reasons why the male fireflies do so. So, reason number one, researchers in Mexico actually found out that the flashing and posing patterns of different species of fireflies are actually different. The male fireflies, by glowing and switching off together in a specific pattern, are sending out signals to the females on the ground as to what group, what tree to focus on. So basically what they are saying is, if you belong to our species, please come to us and don't go to, for example, the guys on the tree next door because they are of different species. The second reason that scientists suggest is that when a male is not glowing, not flashing light, he might use the darkness to actually see where the females are on the ground. Now, imagine you're a firefly and you are randomly just flashing the light with no synchronization at all. So there's a high chance that your non-glow time, your non-flashing time, might coincide with the flashing time of your neighboring male firefly and vice versa. So the net result is that there's no single moment of complete darkness where any firefly, any male firefly on the tree, can see the females on the ground. So as important as flashing is the non-flashing time as well. So when they achieve spontaneous synchronization, they glow together, they flash light together, but more importantly, they also switch their lights off together. They also pose together. And that posing together creates a complete darkness where it's very easy for male fireflies to identify females on the ground. So that's the second explanation, evolutionary explanation, as to why these fireflies actually go for spontaneous synchronization. So that was all living organisms. So far, we talked about fish, birds, and of course, fireflies. Now, let's bring our focus to non-living things, i.e. metronomes. Metronomes stand out in this crowd because they are the only inanimate things in this whole bunch. Despite being dead, non-living, they still do demonstrate spontaneous synchronization. So how do they do that? Let's find out. Well, all you need is a bunch of metronomes. And metronomes, if you don't know what they are basically types of oscillators like this. And so they go to and fro. They have an arm, and this arm moves like a pendulum. So it has a frequency. And they produce a ticking sound. They are used in music. If you are learning piano or any other musical instrument, they actually help you to learn music. I have never used them personally, but I've seen people using them. Anyway, so basically, they are oscillators. They go to and fro, and they can be set to different beats per minute. So you can set them as low as, I think, 40 beats per minute, and it can go up to as max as around 208. You can set different beats per minute. Now, these metronomes here are set to around 176 beats per minute, and they all are started at random timings out of sync. And as you can see, within 30 to 50 seconds, these metronomes get into ticking in sync with each other. Doesn't matter how many metronomes, 5, 20, 50, 100, 1000, 10,000, the number doesn't matter. What matters is the settings of the experiment. Now, if you pay a little attention, you will see all of these metronomes are put on a very lightweight platform. Something like a thin sheet of styrofoam, or polystyrene, or thermocol, or something like that. Very lightweight material. Now, this platform is further supported by cylindrical soda cans, or something cylindrical in nature. So this lightweight platform reacts to the to and fro motions of these metronomes. The cylindrical cans move and roll, and hence they provide balance to the platform. Now this set of lightweight platform and cans leads to a weak coupling of the metronomes on the platform. But this weak coupling gives enough feedback to each metronome to sync with its immediate neighbors. So each metronome weakly coupled, weakly aligned with its neighboring metronome, just like in the case of fireflies, birds, and fish, tries to get in sync with each other. The result? Within less than a minute, all 100 or so metronomes get their ticks in sync, leading to spontaneous synchronization. Not only do we see all the arms ticking in sync with each other, but we can actually hear them ticking in perfect harmony. So let's have a listen to that. Isn't that amazing? Now that raises a very important question. Do we actually need to be even alive to achieve spontaneous synchronization? Do we need to have a brain? Do we need to have a consciousness to achieve spontaneous synchronization? Do we need to have a group thinking to achieve spontaneous synchronization? And the metronome phenomena actually suggest that we don't need all of that. As long as the organisms or the things are of the same nature, and as long as they have a system which can provide a weak coupling to neighboring units, neighboring organisms, neighboring metronomes, this spontaneous synchronization is achievable. So the main takeaway is, it's the system that matters. How many units, how many organisms, how many things doesn't matter. Living or dead doesn't matter. Conscious or unconscious doesn't matter. Smart or stupid doesn't matter. As long as a system exists that can create a weak coupling between neighbors, spontaneous synchronization is possible. And that to me is mind-boggling. In fact, Mr. Kuramoto, a great mathematician, back in 1975, actually found a mathematical way of solving this problem of spontaneous synchronization. And so he developed this thing called the Kuramoto Model, and this equation actually defines Kuramoto Model. For the purposes of this video, the only thing that you have to focus is on the term K. Now, K is what we call coupling constant, and it has been observed that as long as K tends towards 1, the value 1, spontaneous synchronization is actually possible. And what makes this equation even more important is it not only explains the spontaneous synchronization behavior of, for example, metronome oscillators, but more importantly, it can also explain the spontaneous synchronization in biological oscillators. Now, what do you mean by biological oscillators? Well, some examples are our heartbeat. I'm very certain that if you're watching this video, you have a beating heart at this point of time. When you see the ECG of your heartbeat, that actually is just a graphical depiction of the oscillations that your heart goes through. What else? Circadian rhythms. The secretion of insulin from pancreas. So these are all examples of biological oscillators. Take for example, our heart. Our heart will beat about 3 billion times in its lifetime. Whatever rate of heartbeat you have, it beats per minute, it is constant. So if you have 60 beats per minute, it will stay 60 beats per minute in resting condition. That's kind of fascinating. Why is it fascinating? It's because what gives the heartbeat is actually a collection of about 10,000 neurons on the upper right side of your heart. And this bunch of neurons is collectively called as SA node. Now this SA node, as I said, is a collection of 10,000 neurons, but these neurons are very special. Usually, neurons need an external stimulus to fire. But these neurons are special. They have the ability to self-fire in spontaneous synchronization. So what they do is, somehow they have a clock, they have an oscillator inside of them, and they synchronize just the same way. Imagine 10,000 metronomes on a large but lightweight platform achieving spontaneous synchronization and ticking together. The same way, these 10,000 nerve cells, they somehow align themselves with each other in such a way that they fire up together so that one beat of the heart is completed. So that in itself is very amazing. Not only at organism level, but even on cellular level, we see this phenomena of spontaneous synchronization. I hope you liked this video. Thank you for watching. And as always, please like, subscribe, and share this video. And I'll see you in the next one. Until then, bye-bye.